Welcome to another edition of the 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge Show. And I'm your host, Mr. Controversy. Did you miss me? And yes, you know I got my main man. I can't do this by myself. Mr. Glass, what's going on, Glass?
What's up, fam? What's up, fans of the sports talk of the 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge? It's a beautiful Saturday morning, October 3rd, 2015. Everybody getting ready for their college football, prepping for their NFL Sunday. As always, I'm going to bring you the Cup of Joe Sports Person of the Week, sponsored by my coffee maker upstairs. The Sports Person of the Week is Chris Sales. Yes, I'm throwing a little shade, bro. Chris Sales of the Chicago White Sox. The starting pitcher now holds the Chicago White Sox single season strikeout record after reaching 270 for the season in the second inning of the 2-1 win over the Detroit Tigers Friday night. Sales broke Ed Walsh franchise mark of 269 set in 1908. Walsh set his record in 464 innings, while Sales needed 203 innings to beat him. His average this season is 11.8 strikeouts per nine innings, which is also a club record. And only three left-handers since 2004 had more strikeouts in a season is Clayton Kershaw, 294 in 2015, Randy Johnson, 290 in 2004, and Dave Price, 271 in 2014. So kudos and a cup of Joe raise to Chris Sales of the Chicago White Sox.
All right, there you have it. Hey, you see I had to put on my Cubs.
Yeah, I peeped it, man.
It's cool. You know, I don't dislike the White Sox, so, I mean, White Sox cool. I stayed almost right around the corner. I'm just a Cubs fan. So, and to let everybody know, also, you can go to the 3-Point Conversion YouTube channel. We are streaming live. We're shooting the show live, so you can go ahead and watch that. So, we got the video, plus we're on Spreaker Radio, the 3-Point Conversion Spreaker Station. So, trying to do it. So, of course, you know, some crazy things that went on this week. So, hey, man, let's get it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is crazy, Glass. Listen to this, man. So Louisville, you know, Louisville basketball team, Rick Pitino, good university for basketball. You know, they do their thing. But all of a sudden, they're investigating and looking into these allegations from a soon-to-be-published book called Breaking the Cardinal Rules, Basketball and the Escort Queen. So right there, that title was kind of weird. So anyway, the book is revealing, or it reveals that the school had been running an escort company for recruits with strippers and prostitutes. Glass, you hear me? Strippers and prostitutes for these recruits coming in.
Okay. For real, for real.
For real, for real.
You know how the saying go. If you ain't cheating, you ain't trying. Anyway. you know, I heard a book just came out yesterday, Friday night. It was released by IBJ Book Publishing in Indianapolis. The book alleges that the former director of basketball operation, Andre McGee, who also played for Louisville from 2005-2009, paid an escort service for 4 years to provide sex to teenage recruits and to help woo them to come to the Cardinals team. From what I understand, McGee knew Katina Powell, the author of the book, and a self-admitted escort in Louisville. And it says there was certainly nothing nefarious or inappropriate at all.
Stop it. Stop it.
Number one.
I want to know your thoughts.
If you know the name of the prostitute, we got problems right there.
That's what I'm saying. That's exactly what I'm saying.
You know what I'm saying?
You know, the funny thing is, You might have some cats that get theirs. This is an adult show. I mean, we have kids listening, but I'll just say, keep it clean. They get theirs. Then they say, you know what? Nah, I'm going somewhere else. But anyway, let's keep it moving, just like they did.
Right. All right.
So, Andrew Luck is questionable for Sunday's game against the Jacksonville Jaguars. I mean, it's just keeping getting worse and worse for Indianapolis, man. What you think?
Let me ask you a question. Did you have him going to the Super Bowl? Was that you?
Hey, I had him going to the Super Bowl.
I just wanted to.
It's still early. It's still early, but wow.
You know, I think Andrew Luck injured his shoulder in the Titans game last week. And, of course, like you said, he's questionable this week against the Jacksonville Jaguars. Number one, let me let y'all know, I picked the Jacksonville Jaguars to upset the Colts this week, just putting it out there.
Wow.
The head coach, Pagano, said that he was limited in practice for Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday.
He was limited? Yeah.
He was limited.
Yeah.
And they got the veteran Matt Hasselbeck getting ready just in case he goes in. And I think they brought in journeyman Josh Johnson Friday. So it ain't looking good for Luck. And let's not forget, Luck has not missed a game since he's been in the league these four seasons. So
right,
they're not prepared for this.
But you know what? I have faith that Luck will come in and play. So, I mean, he's just a warrior. Like I said, to me, he's like top three when it comes to competitors as far as NFL quarterbacks. So moving on, Hope Solo. Oh my God, this might be one woman at time of most men are scared of. She has been charged with domestic violence again as a case. It was a case earlier with her with domestic violence where she went to her sister's home, her half sister's home, mm-hmm. beat up her son, slamming her against the concrete, and then she started punching the half-sister in the face. That's what the half-sister is saying. Hope Solo says she was the one that was
victimized.
Violated, yeah. Mm-hmm. So it was thrown out, but now it has been reversed. The judge and the court has reversed it. So now she's dealing with that. So real quick, Glass, do you think that she should be – what I think they suspended did – no, they didn't suspend her yet. They didn't mm-hmm. do anything because she plays Major League Soccer.
Right.
On the team. Sorry, I just don't pay attention to women's soccer. But all I know is that they hadn't suspended. So what you think about that?
Listen, man, you don't see the writing on the wall. You don't see the conspiracy of this whole situation. She got, what was this, last year?
Yeah, I see it. Uh-huh.
In July. That was before the World Cup.
Right.
They said that she was not guilty. She played in the World Cup. Now the higher court's bringing her back up in there, reinstating the case. Come on, man. Listen, everybody knew what was going on. I'm not mad. Go ahead, work the system if you want to. But yeah, that's all it is. She won the World Cup. Now they go take it back to court and handle their business. So that's how I see it.
Yeah, man. That seems kind of sketchy. But hey, we're USA.
Right. I'm with
that. So moving on. Here we go with the bad news again. Irvin Fryer has been sentenced to 5 years in prison after being found guilty of conspiracy and theft by deception charges. I'm wondering, did the brother – come on, bro. Well, first of all, y'all, let me let you know he was dealing with – I'm pretty sure Glass got the notes on this, but I know he was dealing with he said homes, and I think he was
– a mortgage.
Go ahead.
He was selling mortgages.
Mortgages, right. So my thing is, Fryer, for you to have to steal and lie, well, I guess they weren't paying money back then. So, but he had a good good career, man. He played like 12 to 15 years.
Actually, 17 years.
17. That's right, because he was like 38 playing. I remember that.
Right.
Your take.
Okay, you know, he used to play for the Philadelphia Eagles. I used to like his style of playing. Mm-hmm. He's 53 now. Like you said, he's going to jail for 5 years for mortgage fraud, and I guess he was double dipping, taking money from, I think, six banks, they said, and this team totaled more than over $1 million. Not only him, but his mother, Aline McGahey, 74 years old, she gets sentenced for 3 years probation. So it's a family thing. And just like, you know, if you've seen the ESPN 30 for 30 broke, when they talk about all the players losing money.
He was on there.
Lost some money, you know what I'm saying? And he's trying to scrap some money back.
Right.
From what I last understand, he was or still is a pastor of Mount Holly Church. So,
no, why you put that in?
Yeah,
no.
I'm sorry. I just had to put it out there.
Pastor,
man.
What?
He a pastor, man.
Come on, bro. come on. I'm a preacher's kid. You making us look bad. Come
right?
on, bro. Get it together. Moving on. I know people are going to get a kick out of this. So this week, I think it was reported Wednesday or Thursday, Derrick Rose underwent surgery for a fracture. Basically he got elbowed in the face and fractured his face, some bones in his face. I don't know. But all I know is he had to have surgery, but he's only going to be out for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
My take on it real quick, Glass, is the fact that I'm kind of happy. People say, why are you happy, Mr. Controversy? Think about it. Because he has to wear that mask. Everybody who has worn that mask goes off. Kevin Durant, Russell Westbrook, LeBron, Kobe, Rip Hamilton. Everybody who has worn that mask goes off. So expect Derrick Rose to be blazing this season or the beginning of the season.
Listen, man, I agree with everything that you're saying. If the mask helped, he should have had his socket broke a long time ago. I'm just saying, put it out there. I like Derrick Rose. He's a hometown kid. He started off good, but he's getting kind of diva-ish, if you ask me, man. So let's talk. All right, he's coming back.
Yeah, we're gonna bring it up. Yeah,
he blow up nothing. Let's talk about the elephant in the room, bro. The money.
Right. So he came. So this week, during the media day for the Chicago Bulls, he was asked a question about going into free agency. And he's scheduled to go into free agency in 2017. So they asked him about how he feels about it. And Derrick Rose came out and said he's preparing for free agency in 2017. I'm going to get my money. That's all I'm worried about. He never said he was leaving the team, but he just said it's all about his money. You know, he's living comfortable, but he still has to, you know, prepare for his child, and it's all about the money. He had a lot of flack about it. So, Glass, go ahead. How do you feel about it?
Stop it. Just stop it, man. Now, this is why Chicago is starting to dislike Derrick Rose. We in 2015, and you think about – your free agency 2 years down the road, 2 years, not next year, 2 years down the road. This man only played 100 games in the past four seasons. He signed a five-year, $94.3 million contract with the Bulls back in 2011. And this knucklehead has a 13-year, $185 million contract with Adidas. Damn it, how much does your son need to survive?
You know what, though? I hear that, and we're going to keep it moving, but I'll say this. He didn't say he was leaving. They asked him the question. I think his problem is you have to know how to answer, and somebody needs to train him because I think he tried to go the route as far as with the Chicago Bulls. Think about it. In the past, when LeBron came out and said something about money, Kobe, whatever other big free agents came and said something about money, they got their money. And it was like, basically, they put it, it was like to, I guess, pressure the organization. But like you said, when you haven't played this many games, you've been hurt every year for the last 3 to 4 years, it looks bad. So
don't give him an out, man. This man been in the league long enough. He know how to talk to the
That's league. Why I said somebody need to talk to him.
Jimmy Butler been in the league shorter than him, and he know how to speak to the media. So you just trying to tell me you just stupid. You stuck on stupid. How many times you need to mess up?
I'm not going to say stuck on stupid, but that joke only been in college for 1 year, so.
Let's move on, man. Good move.
Tristan Thompson. I never heard of this before. So Tristan Thompson hasn't showed up for training camp. So basically, he's holding out. Glass, when is the last time you heard of an NBA player holding out for the season? Are you thinking in the NFL? What's going on?
Hey, man, you know what? I ain't mad at the brother. From what I understand, I think July, they almost had signed him up for a five-year, $80 million deal. They didn't sign. They come to find out Draymond Green, a Golden State Warriors, signed for $82 million for 5 years. I guess he figured he worth more than Draymond Green, so he just like, man, we gotta go back to the table, get me more money.
Right.
They can't come to conclusion. The man said, last I heard, he was gonna sign a 1-year tender where that will make him a free agent next year, not restricted, but the straight up free agents. So I think that'd be a good move for him, because if you ask me, the man needed his money, because out of everybody on that team that helped LeBron James in the postseason, Tristan was the most consistent player to back LeBron James. So yeah, he deserved more money than Anderson, Vierjau, Kevin Love. That's just me. So right. Get your money, bro.
No, I'm with you, man. I just think this is going to be a trend. And I think now he's starting something where players are going to follow and they're going to hold out. I mean, this is like probably the first time we've seen this before. I know in my lifetime,
right?
First time I ever heard of this. So moving on, this is about to be my stop it moment, but Jonathan Papelbon gets suspended 4 games by the Washington Nationals for getting in a fight with Bryce Harper. It just doesn't sit well with me. It doesn't even read well. Last I remember, I don't think he went and just attacked Bryce Harper. Bryce Harper told him, if you want some, come down here. So why is Papelbon getting suspended, but Harper's not?
Evidently, they don't like – people in the media was telling me that they didn't like the way Papelbon choked out Bryce Harper.
You're wrong for that.
Bryce Harper.
You're wrong for that.
He's the MVP of the league. Of the league. He's a young gun. I think he's smelling himself. You know what I'm saying? And Jonathan Papelbon, being the veteran, trying to check and put him back up in this place. But let's not forget, a couple of games ago, Papelbon hit Manny Machado on September 23rd, and Bryce didn't have his back. And that's like a rule between the players. Like, dude, you don't put your teammate up on the bus. So it was kind of fueled up. And just like you said, if you want to say let's go, be prepared to go.
I don't like that, though. What he said, like you said, Bryce Harper, when Papelbon hit the guy.
Machado.
And Bryce came in and told Papelbon, basically, hey, man, why you do that? Now you know they're going to aim for me.
Right.
Stop being a – man, boy. You know what I want to say. Stop being a punk, man. Stand up for your teammates.
Right. See, so I can't blame Papelbon for doing what he's doing. But
right.
It sounds like he's not going to be on the team anymore.
No.
Jersey up out the store. I feel bad for him. He just bought a $2.9 million house about a week before he choked out Bryce Harper. So, okay.
But I'll tell you this, though. He will get another job. You know, even though he got fired for choking out Bryce Harper, he will get another job. Before we end it, I just want to say that I think that's what Nationals need. The Nationals need. They need that fire. That's why he got mad at Bryce, because – he didn't run the bases. So, I mean, hey, I guess lesson learned, run the bases or you will get choked out.
Yeah.
So, that concludes the quick hits. We will take a quick break and we will be back with the NFL Huddle. Okay, so we're back. So, Glass, Thursday night showcased the Baltimore Ravens and the Pittsburgh Steelers. It was another down-to-the-wire game. I mean, I'm not going to say it was a good game, but it was down-to-the-wire. And This is my thing with this game. First of all, the score was 23-20. If you haven't heard, I don't know where you are or where you've been, but 23-20 in overtime. Josh Scobie missed 10 field goals. I'm sorry, missed 2 field goals. It seemed like he missed, 15?
Right.
He had a chance to seal the game, and he didn't. And Baltimore came back, and they won the game. Vic started for – he started for Ben Roethlisberger, and
he did a pretty good job, man.
He did all right. I mean, he missed some passes though, like especially that pass late.
The last pass to
Brown in the flat.
Yeah,
Yeah, so that was horrible.
Number one, like you said, it was a good game. I knew it was going to be a hard-hitting game. Both teams missing key players. Pittsburgh more so than Ravens. Everybody jumping on Josh Scobie, but let's not forget, Josh Scobie is not their number one kicker. I can't remember the first names.
Sweet. Yeah.
First one, he tore his ACL. Sweet. The second one had a hamstring pull or something. So this is the third string. So you get what you pay for. I'm sure he's not going to be on the team next week. And I think Coach Tomlin couldn't trust that kicker anymore. So that's the reason why he ran that plays. And if Vic completed that play to Antonio Brown, we could be talking about the Pittsburgh Steelers win instead of a Ravens win. So it is what it is, man.
Well, this is what I say, man. What with Vic, it's like, I understand he's getting old. And I mean, I'm pretty sure everybody want to use that excuse. But remember, Vic, when he came from jail, man, or prison, Vic was on fire.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like now he's – I think he got to the point where he wasn't looking to start anywhere. I think he kind of gave up on starting.
Right.
And then he got signed by Pittsburgh. Because look when he was with the Jets. You remember the game where he the game where Geno got hurt.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think when he got knocked out. This is last year. But when he got hurt and mm-hmm. And Geno – so Geno was out and they brought Vic in. So Vic wasn't ready to play. Came in, looked horrible, and he even said he wasn't prepared. He didn't prepare. I mean, he didn't prepare for the game. Come on, Vic. You're supposed to be a professional.
Right.
You know, at least don't say it. I mean, I think sometimes him being in prison got him to be too honest and too truthful. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, Clawson, look at Jimmy Clawson 2 weeks ago. When he came in, he wasn't ready, but he didn't say, I wasn't prepared. We knew he wasn't prepared, but you don't say that.
But see, there's a difference, man. We know what to expect from Jimmy Clawson. You ain't never going to be prepared. Michael Vick, on the other hand, we don't expect the Vick experiment, but we expect some type of quality quarterback in Michael Vick. So.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, but speaking of that, let's move to the NFC. I want to talk about right now, who is the best team in the NFC, Glass? I want to know, who do you think is the best team in the NFC?
Okay.
We have the Arizona Cardinals, Green Bay Packers, Carolina Panthers, Atlanta Falcons. They're all 3-0. Even though Seattle looks horrible, you still – I mean, they got their man back. And Cam Chancellor, they're still a dangerous team. Glass, who do you have as the best team in the NFC?
Right now, we're in week four, so it's early. But with that being said, if the NFC championship started now, I would expect to see the Green Bay Packers and the Arizona Cardinals there. I hear what you say about the Seahawks, but let's not throw no shade on the Cardinals. I think the Cardinals are a more all-around team. Offense, defense, special team.
Mm-hmm.
Green Bay Packers, of course, you got the great one, Aaron Rodgers, but you don't have enough defense to me. And I believe the Cardinals will be, if right now everything's said and done, the Cardinals are the best team in the NFC.
I'm with you. Green Bay, you know I hate Green Bay because I'm a Chicago Bears fan.
Of course.
I can't stand them. But – excuse me. The thing about Green Bay, their defense is really not that good. But when your offense is clicking, your defense plays better. Just as if you're a defensive team, when the defense is clicking, the offense all of a sudden start to play better. But if Green Bay has a game where they're struggling offensively, I guarantee you they won't be a good team because that defense is not that good. The offense is higher than the defense. So now when you're up two or three touchdowns, it's kind of hard to, you know, play a balanced game. You know, now you have to throw. So it's predictable. So now we know what to set in. So that's why I don't have Green Bay as the best team in the NFC. even though they're scary. But you know they play each other this year too. So, I mean, we will see. What you think about the Falcons? Because with the Falcons, we all know they're one-dimensional pretty much. Even though Devontae Freeman looked good against Dallas Cowboys, against the Dallas Cowboys. So, when I say one-dimensional as far as, you know, if Julio gets hurt, it's a wrap. But still, that doesn't discredit the team. Mm-hmm. So, the defense is getting better. It's still young. It's still a new scheme. So, I think by week nine is when you'll see that team really blossom. So, do you think that Atlanta Falcons can make a push?
Atlanta Falcons, the truth. I believe – I said on another show that the Atlanta Falcons was going to win the NFC South. I don't put too much trust in the Carolina Panthers right now. Falcons are the most all-around team in the NFC South. But just like what you said, I don't consider them a one-dimensional team, really. Of course, like you said, if Julio Jones go down, if Devontae Freeman don't play like he's been playing as of yet, team going to be shot in the NFC. But from what I'm seeing, Dan Quinn got that team momentum on high. The whole thing is if they stay healthy in this run in 2015-2016 season, they look good. I'm impressed with what I see, but they got to stay healthy. If them two cogs go down, if Matt Ryan go down, Julio Jones go down, Devontae Freeman go down, it's a wrap. You know what I'm saying? Roddy, I don't know where Roddy White is yet. He hasn't showed up. So
they phasing him out, man. They're phasing him out. They're phasing him out. That's been the talk here in Atlanta.
Okay.
I'm telling you, they're phasing him out because they don't want to pay that contract. They want him to leave. It's kind of bogus because he's been open on certain plays.
Yeah. But that's the NFL. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's what have you done for me lately? He done great when he first got into the league. And just like you said, they phasing him out because he's not – he's I ain't going to say useless, but he's not as profitable for the team like he was back in the beginning.
Right. And they want Hankerson to come in. Hankerson's garbage. I don't even know why they – but – so what about the Panthers? Because the Panthers are in that South Division. Are they – a real team? Do you believe that they're for real? Shout out to Big Q.
Big Q gonna hate what I have to say about his Panthers, but it's between them and the Falcons, and I think the Falcons got them faded. I'm not putting my money into the Carolina Panthers for the simple fact they basically don't have a run game. They don't have that one wide receiver. I asked them, give me one number one receiver you have on the team. You can't give it to me. All they got is Cam Newton,
right?
And their defense. And you're gonna need more than that to make a nice little stretch in a postseason. That's just me. So now I ain't putting too much faith in. I know they 3-0, but I'm not putting no faith into Carolina Panthers making it advancing in the. They might make it to the playoffs, wild card, but they won't advance too deep in the playoffs.
Yeah, I don't think Panthers – I had them as my counterfeit team. I took a lot of flack about that. But I don't think they're as good as their record say they are. They haven't – I mean, they're playing a schedule, so you can't get mad at that. They're not playing great teams anyway. That doesn't count because the Arizona's not either. So I'm not even going – I shouldn't even brought that up. But my thing about the Carolina Panthers are if you take away – Greg Olsen, who else is Cam throwing to?
Exactly.
Now, Cam, should he – right now, I know it's three games, but this is how we do it. We're fans. We're not experts. So as far as the MVP, right now the league offensively, I think it's between Julio and Cam Newton. I think Cam Newton has played his tail off. Considering what he has, Glass, we haven't seen Cam throw those high balls like he usually does. We hadn't seen Cam make that dumb mistake. He's played sound football, running at the right time. I like the way – if it wasn't for Cam, they wouldn't be 3-0. I'm just saying. So he's carrying that team. But –
Let me clear this up, bro. Hold up, bro. Let me clear this up. Did you say Julio Jones and Cam Newton for MVP of the league? Let me clear this up. Make sure I heard it right.
So far. I'm saying so far. Not they won't be. so far. You can't tell me what other team has carried their team like Cam has. Cam has nothing. Glad you know that. He has nothing.
Man, let's stop. Listen, man, as much as I hate to even put this out there, Tom Brady got Cam Newton.
Face. I mean, I forgot about – I'm not – Brady don't count. Brady, look, you know how you have in the NBA, you talk sports, and you're like, all right, Jordan don't count. But what other two are like, – Tom Brady don't count. He don't
– Okay.
That don't count. Come on, man.
I do agree with you. I do agree with you on that aspect. Yeah. You know, take the prominent ones out. Yeah, Cam Newton.
Right.
Is the Carolina Panthers.
Right, yeah. Brady doesn't count. He doesn't count. We already know he got it. So
right.
That's a given. Okay. But I'm saying I like what Cam is doing, but still I don't think – the defense is not playing as well. And, of course, Keithley was out. But still, I don't think that Carolina is that good. Like, if you take away Olsen, who else is he going to throw to?
I agree. And I get sick and tired of people putting this on Cam Newton. This is not Cam Newton's fault.
No.
It's the organization's fault for not giving him the weapons that he needs to advance in the playoffs. So all y'all out there that's trying to blame it on Cam Newton, y'all need to stop. Cam Newton do what he's supposed to be doing. Cam Newton is progressing as a mature, progressive quarterback in the NFL. You gotta understand that. You got to recognize that. Right. So don't put it on Cam Newton. Put it on the organization for not giving him the weapons.
Right. So because he don't have the weapons and the wide receivers, let's switch this.
Okay.
It's been a lot of talk. We talked about Julio. Julio had a monster game. Mm-hmm. AJ Green said, okay, I see your 165 yards and two touchdowns, and I will raise you. An extra, 45 yards, something like that? Because he had like 230, I think.
Right.
So, something like that he had. I know he had over 200 yards. So, with him, Julio, still got Demaryius Thomas, who's playing with a wounded quarterback. Mm-hmm. Who is the best receiver in the NFL, Glass?
Oh, man. Julio looking good. But hands down, it's Antonio Brown of the Pittsburgh Steelers. I think last week was the first week he did not have a 50, five receiving 50 yard catch that broke that record.
And that's his fault. It's his fault because he had five catches, but he dropped that touchdown pass. His fault.
Right.
So, not blaming that on Vic. His fault.
Yeah, but with that being said, right as of right now, I'm not saying he's going to stay there, but as of right now, I said Antonio Brown is the top wide receiver. Julio Jones is right behind him. And I'm just going to put it out there. The surprise in the league right now, according to wide receivers, is Steve Smith Sr.
Yeah.
That old man is third in the league in catches with 373. Really? Above AJ Green, above Larry Fitzgerald, all the other wide receivers, he's third in the league. So –
I'm not surprised. Yeah. You know how Steve Smith is. I think Steve has games and spurts now. He won't have 16 weeks where he'll have where 14 or 13 of those 16 weeks he'll go for 100 yards plus or even 80 yards plus.
Right.
But Steve Smith is a beast. Yeah. I agree. It has to be Antonio Brown. But Julio is right there.
He's almost
– like, Antonio Brown is 6'11". Julio is 6'10" right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because Julio is getting it. He's getting it. And he's dominating the game.
Right.
I love the way he's playing, man. Like, AJ game was ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
But still, to me, Julio's game was more impressive than AJ's. Just because they couldn't stop him. He had, 12 catches?
Right.
12 catches, man. So that meant – every time it was third and seven and third and six, you knew where the ball was going. You couldn't stop him. Double team, you couldn't stop him.
Right.
That's what I'm talking about. But I like how Demaryius Thomas is playing. He was chirping with that fumble. I like the way he's playing. I like how he's being aggressive, man. He's taking over games. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to put him in. And Larry Fitzgerald, not saying he's the best, but What a story, man.
He was a wrap. Reborn, bro.
You said what?
He's reborn, man. He's back to his youthful days back in the, back when he first got into the league, man.
Yeah, he is. So let me ask you this. You talked about the biggest surprise in wide receiver. What is your biggest surprise in the NFL period? Like, who or what is your biggest surprise?
I'm going to say, you know what? Like I said, I'm going to have to stick with Steve Smith right now because you can't beat that. Dude, damn, he's what, 37, 38 years 30 old?
Years old.
Doing this thing. I know this is last year, but hey, you got to recognize that. I mean, then once again, Devontae Freeman of Atlanta Falcons, he's trucking over people we didn't expect.
Good, doesn't he?
You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, there's a you can go a lot of ways of surprises, but those two come to my mind right now.
My biggest surprise
back in that. Go ahead.
Is the Indianapolis Colts.
In a bad way.
In a bad way, right.
Yeah.
We just didn't – I picked them to lose to Buffalo.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I didn't expect it to be like it was, but I thought it was going to be closer than what it was, but I expected them to lose to Buffalo. Mm-hmm. But I didn't expect them to lose to – the funny thing is after watching that game, I picked them to lose to the Jets. So you're like, how are they your surprise? But that was going back from what I saw in the Buffalo game. And they didn't play better. Like, I didn't think they would – like I said, the Buffalo game I picked them to lose, I didn't think that they would play like that. Mm-hmm. Even with the New York Jets game, I thought it would be difficult for Luck to get yards over Revis because – especially because T.Y. was injured. They mm-hmm. came – you know, he came in the game. He was hurt. They didn't know if he was going to play or not. But the way they played, the way he is playing – and I've been saying that Luck throws interceptions. You know how we have when we had our battlegrounds. I've said that, but the way he's been playing. And then you play Tennessee in Tennessee, which I thought was a gimme. It might not be a gimme now the way Tennessee is playing, right. But you're down by 14 in the fourth quarter. This is your division. Yes, they won, but they almost gave the game back when Mariota drove them down the field.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Come on, man. Also, that's another one. I think that you have to say that with Mariota, the way he's playing, he's a surprise. He looks good.
Mm-hmm.
He looks good. But Tyrod Taylor, I don't think anyone, even though I knew he was going to play well, I didn't think he would play to this magnitude.
I agree. I agree with Tyrod Taylor. I forgot about him. I don't know how I forgot about him. He's jamming. But give you my thoughts on the Indianapolis Colts. I agree with everything you said. I'm just going to piggyback off of that. The team, the way they assembled the team and the way the team is playing right now reminds me of the 2010 Philadelphia Eagles. You got all these players, all these all-stars coming up in here, and everybody, even I drank the Kool-Aid. I drank the Green Apple Kool-Aid. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I think they was going to jam it. And they just fizzed out. They didn't even – because it doesn't matter if you got all the great players at that time. If you don't have that chemistry, it's not going to work. That's what it looks like is going on right now. Number one, I can't remember the head coach name right now for the Colts. It's hitting me, but he's having problems with management.
Yeah, Chuck Pagano. Yeah.
Chuck Pagano. And you brought in these players, but they're not meshing. You brought in Andre Johnson from the Texans. He looks like a tight end. He gained so much weight. He's not moving around like he used to. So my thing is this. Why did you bring in Andre Johnson when you could have just paid Reggie Wayne? Reggie Wayne wasn't shady. He was up to par. You should have just kept Reggie Wayne, left Andre Johnson out there. But you trying to build – you trying to assemble the – as Vince, my man said, dream team.
Right.
Don't do it like that. It's not a quick process. You got to have the players have that chemistry. It's going to take a while. So I believe they're going to bounce back because, hell, the AFC South, everybody's 1-2. So they got time to bounce back. Only team they really got to worry about is the Tennessee Titans, which, like you said, is a surprise. But, you know, we'll see how it goes. But, yeah, the Colts, they got time to get their stuff together, but they got to get their stuff together.
Right, right. All right, so that's going to wrap it up for the NFL Huddle. We're going to take a quick break, And we will be back with Mr. Vincent, the fantasy guru. We'll be back. All right, so we are back in the 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge. Glass, real quick, man, how's your fantasy team looking?
I'll just put you like this. I had Ben Roethlisberger in doggone 2 or 3 of my league, and I'm scrapping. I'm looking good, but then I'm not looking good. I'm falling apart at the seams as it is with Big Ben out the picture. So, but I can't complain.
Yeah, I had Big Ben also, and that's the league I'm 3-0 in, and lost on that. Well, no, I haven't lost yet. I'm sorry, I'm 3-0, but when I lost Big Ben, I was sick. So I have Derek Carr as my backup.
Good pick, especially this week. Great pickup.
Right, so I have Derek Carr as my backup, and I have Vic as my thank God I didn't play Vic.
Okay.
I didn't play Vic. And in one league, I'm 2-1, 2-1, and 3-0. I'm only in 3 leagues this year. But I picked up Tyrod Taylor in one league, man. He was still out there?
Wow.
Yeah. And you know what? The funny thing is I was debating, like, who should I get? Should I get Flacco? He only got 5 points. Should I get Flacco? Who else is out there? Fitzpatrick. I didn't know. So guess who I asked? I asked Vincent the Fantasy Juru. And he told me to get Tyrod Taylor.
Oh, there you go.
And speaking of him, we have Mr. Juru here himself. What's going on, man? How you doing?
What's going on, fellas? How you guys doing this morning?
All right, all right.
We good. Hey, man, I was talking about our fantasy teams. Talking about Ben, that was a big loss. Before you get to your odds and alls, and you might have something about that, like, who would you say, if they haven't been picked up yet, who would you go with as far as to get either a backup? Because they probably, more than likely, they already have a backup. But who else would you bring in?
Well, since Brady's out on a bye week, you know, a lot of people have been, you know, asking me questions about, you know, who's the best, you know, pickup, you know, guys like Brady, Drew Brees being out, you know. So one of my first picks, especially for this week, I like Derek Carr for the Oakland Raiders. I think he's a great fantasy pickup. Yep. If you do not own him, I really like him. Being his second year in the league, he has 2 great receivers to throw to. He looks confident with the ball. You know, he's definitely one of my top quarterbacks, especially for this week, you know, week 4.
Right, yeah. And I was just telling Glass that I did pick him up. Well, I had him already. So I will start him in place of Big Ben this week against my Chicago Bears. So. That's all right.
He'll help you win, though. He may help you win.
Yeah. I know, right? That's real quick, that's the great part. When I went to the game 2 weeks ago when we played Arizona Cardinals, and I started, instead of Peyton, I started Palmer. So I started Palmer, and my boy, Chicago Bears fan, he was like, man, how you going to start Palmer in this game, man? I said, hey, I'm rooting for the Bears to win, but just in case we get blown out, it's a win-win because I know Carson going to have a great game, and he did.
That's the curse of fantasy. So
that's what I'm going with this week. Hopefully we win, but if not, hey, I take real life before fantasy. But if real life pan out, hey, I'm going with fantasy. But go ahead, Vince, man. Talking about quarterbacks, why don't you start with your alls and nulls for the quarterback position?
Hey, one definitely Derek Carr playing against the Bears. I really like Derek Carr this week. He's a great bye week replacement for if you guys own Brady, if you own Mariota, so forth. You know, I definitely like Derek Carr this week. I also like Andy Dalton. One of the, you know, Andy Dalton was a top five fantasy quarterback when 2013. He's looking like he's coming back to that form again. He is one of the hottest quarterbacks out right now. He's definitely on my start list. I'm actually have him in a league where I'm like, man, should I start Dalton or should I start Peyton Manning? I don't even know. Right. He's so hot right now in his matchup at home against the Chiefs. I like Dalton a lot. Another quarterback I like is Cam Newton. I don't want everyone to start jumping the gun. I know lately this week everybody's been talking about, oh, Cam, he's, you know, MVP Cam Newton. And
I just talked about that.
Hey, look, stop it. Okay. Stop it right now. I mean, yeah, he's a good quarterback, but I mean, look at his competition. I mean, he played what?
New Orleans.
3-0, but he's played against a weak team.
Right.
So, you know, now after this week, you know, which is like I say, I like his matchup against Tampa Bay. But the next couple weeks after his bye week, he's going against Seattle, Green Bay, you know, Philly. Mm. You know, just calm down, fantasy fans. You know, don't jump on him yet as an MVP. So right. But he has a great matchup this week, start him. My nose. I feel bad, but Matt Stafford, I mean, I think the luck is just running out against him. I mean, garbage. You play at home against Denver last week. Now he's playing against Seattle. Is Seattle this week? don't even worry about starting him this week.
Right.
Teddy Bridgewater, you know, he's playing at home. I mean, no, he's actually playing in Denver. Denver still has not given up a touchdown to wide receiver yet.
That's crazy.
Let him know.
Say what now?
I said, let him know. I'm a Denver Broncos. Let him know we ain't playing.
Oh my God, Denver! I mean, and I'm not expecting. I expect another goose egg for the wide receivers there too. So I would not. Teddy Bridgewater, no, don't start him this week.
Wait. Has Teddy Bridgewater thrown a touchdown pass to a wide receiver yet?
That, you know what? That's a good question.
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
Look, if you got Stafford and Bridgewater, you might need to jump off a cliff.
Yeah, and actually, one league, I think I might own both quarterbacks.
I'd rather start Stafford than Bridgewater.
Yeah, I think I own both in one league. And you know, there's a few guys that's out there on the waiver wire. I think I picked up Colin Kaepernick. I mean, his
that's bad.
It's sad. It's
all right, man.
It's sad he's at home, but he is at home against Green Bay.
Right.
And you know, I think Green Bay is gonna, you know, of course, beat him. But he have a lot of garbage points. He still runs the ball. Right. So if he gives me 60 to 70 yards on a running, you know, that's still 7 points. Plus, you know, garbage time, you know, I'm expecting decent numbers. But, hey, Stafford and Bridgewater, no.
Right. All right, so who you have as your running back for the odds and alls?
Oh, man, great running back matchups this week, guys. Oh, my gosh. And one, I love Melvin Gordon. Running back for the San Diego Superchargers, man. They're playing at home against the worst running defense in the league. They're playing against the Browns. I think this is going to be his breakout game. You know, of course, he hasn't really did too much so far in 3 weeks. But this week right here, I really like his chances to break out against Cleveland. Another one, Latavius Murray again from Oakland playing against those Bears. I'm sorry, but the Bears gave up what Jared Allen and what is it? Bostic is his name.
Yeah, Bostic. Mm-hmm. I think he was playing.
Yeah, I mean, the Bears are. I mean, it's kind of like in baseball. They just kind of just then pretty much let the season go away from them.
Right.
They get rid of their defensive players. It's looking like You know, Murray's going to have another great great game in the backfield against against the Bears. I like him a lot. I also like Carlos Williams, Buffalo, yeah, at home against the New York Giants. You know, they're not actually playing McCoy this week. So Carlos Williams, who scored touchdowns in the Latin in the first three games, right, for Buffalo, now he has a chance to run the ball, you know, get his 20-plus carries. He's a very good matchup this week against the Giants.
So who's your
My Nas? Oh, my. Alfred Morris, Washington Redskins.
Real quick. Why are they doing him like that? I don't get it.
And I asked myself too, Mr. Controversy and Glass. You know, I own him in a couple leagues, and yeah, I was like, what has he done to not get the ball and not even starting games? You know, I'm like, you know, they said in the beginning that he plays better with RG3 than Cousins. Mm-hmm. But I mean, come on. I mean, the line is still the same. You know, I mean, I know they drafted Matt Jones, but man, I mean, he's not getting no love over there in Washington. Now they split it three ways. From Matt Jones, you got Thompson there, and now you got Morris. I'm like, it's just a mess back there, you know? So I don't like Alfred Morris at all. But again, a lot of fantasy owners may have got Alfred Morris, you know, first or second as your running back. So you may not have that many choices.
Yeah. Right. Yeah,
but anyway, don't, you know, if you have other options, please have my blessings. But right now, he's just not a guy that I would start right now. Also, Lamar Miller from Miami, another disappointment. I mean, it's the line that it goes on and on with running backs, you guys. I mean, these guys were like very high ranked going into the season, yeah, but they have not produced at all. You know, and it's sad. But Lamar Miller, he's battling sore ankle issues. He's only rushed for like 105 yards in three weeks. I mean, come on. It's horrible. So if you have other options, don't start Lamar Miller. And also too, they're playing in London. Make sure you guys get your rosters locked in before 9:30 Eastern Standard Time tomorrow.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Please don't forget, they play early. So definitely get your rosters set early. We'll go to wide receivers now.
Right.
I like Dante Moncrief, you know, from the Colts. Definitely great matchup at home against the Jaguars. We all know Andre Johnson has not been playing well at all. You know, he was very high on my fantasy radar this year, but he just doesn't get the looks. He doesn't look good out there playing for that system. I like Moncrief as a great number two alongside with T.Y. He's definitely one of my starts for this week. Amari Cooper. I keep on throwing all these Raiders out there to you guys.
Understandable.
right. But Amari Cooper, since he's been playing, he's been Derek Carr's favorite weapon. So if I say start Derek Carr, start Amari Cooper, because that's his book. As my Nas. And it's sad to say again, you know, another Detroit Lion, Calvin Megatron Johnson.
Wow, that doesn't even seem right. That doesn't even sound right.
Yeah, to put him as a null. But again, you know, Detroit is one of the worst offenses in the league when it comes to passing the ball downfield for deep throws. And when I'm talking deep throws is 20 yards plus. They're one of the third worst in the league.
So, question real quick to you all. What happened to that Matthew Stafford that used to just chuck it down no matter if Calvin was triple team? He was chucking it. Like, what happened to that?
I have no idea. I mean, it's just sad. I mean, just to see, and Calvin's only – well, I think he just turned 30.
Yeah,
but 30's young for wide receiver.
Exactly.
I mean,
Glass, what do you think?
Dude, man, Matthew Stafford. Everybody know Matthew Stafford. He's a young gun. He throws everywhere. Everybody knows his thing. Running game is subpar, so you ain't got to worry about the run game. You just go back there and stick all the wide receivers and jam them up at the line.
But we talking about Johnson, though. Calvin Johnson used to be triple team. At least he has Abdullah. Detroit had no one back then.
Prime time is undefeated, bro. I understand he's 30, but he got a body. He's been through a lot of injuries too.
So you think it's more on his side? You think? But I'm saying he doesn't even try to throw it to him, like even chuck it up.
Yeah, I don't know.
But I don't think the line. I don't think he has time to throw the ball deep.
That's true. Yeah. Right.
He doesn't have time to throw it deep, you know. So against Calvin Johnson, it doesn't, you know, he doesn't get the chance to get the rock like he should. You know, true. He just hasn't had a great fantasy week so far, you know. So, and damn sure I don't believe he's going to have one against Seattle.
It ain't happening.
Yeah, moving forward, any wide receiver for the Minnesota Vikings. I mean, again, Denver has not allowed a passing touchdown for a receiver this year. So why start Mike Wallace? Why start Charles Johnson? Cal Rudolph? None. I want to start any of them at all. Not this week.
Wow. Right. So who do you have at tight ends? Please tell me there's a Chicago Bears at tight end.
You are absolutely right.
Yes.
Martellus Bennett is my number one fantasy tight end this week, you guys. Playing at home against Oakland's defense, who's given up an average of 16 fantasy points for an opposing tight end. Mm. That makes Bennett a goldmine play for this week. So definitely start Bennett this week. Also, like we talked last week about Jordan Reed from the Washington Redskins. I like him. He's built like a wide receiver. He's averaged about 60 yards receiving. He's third amongst tight ends and targets. Mm. I like Jordan Reed this week as well, playing at home against the Philadelphia Eagles. My tight end, number one is Jordan Cameron from Miami. Again, they're playing in London. I'm not 100% committed in his health. I still feel like he's a little still injury prone. You know, he's been battling injuries for the last 2 weeks. But I just don't like his matchup against the Jets. And the Jets are pretty good against tight ends this season. Another one is Zach Ertz in Philadelphia, you know, playing against the Redskins. He's only – in the 3 weeks so far, he's only had 93 receiving yards.
Wow.
You know, I mean, that's not – and he, you know, supposed to be – he was very high this year in fantasy, but he hasn't – you know, the stats hasn't shown it right now. So, right now, if you have other choices, go with them. But right now, Zach Ertz is, to me, not the best fantasy tight end this week. Defenses. I love the Seahawks. Mm-hmm. I mean, hey, another home game against – Detroit Lions team.
Yeah.
I like their chances, you know, this week. So definitely, if you have Seattle, be very happy.
Right.
Also, Carolina Panthers defense.
Ooh,
that is definitely a good start against Winston. They play in Tampa Bay, but, you know, they got Jared Allen now. So he should definitely put some pressure on Winston. And I like their chances, you know, this weekend to be, you know, to be 4-0. Mm-hmm. One of my defenses that I don't like, the Texans. You remember, this season we were really high on the Texans defense. Yeah. You know, they were like top five.
Right.
But you know, so far, they haven't really got a chance to really stop anyone yet. You know, I'm not saying they, opposing offensive scoring a lot against them, but when you have Julio Jones and Matt Ryan, and they are one of the hottest tandems right now in the NFL, you know, Texans. Definitely, I will not start this week.
Okay. All right.
Good stuff.
So, what is that sleeper that you say, hey, you might need to start him? What sleeper do you have out right now that you think we should start?
Ooh. Oh, gosh. Just looking at the lineups now. Like I said, right now, like I said, I like – you know, and not like I said, not being a homer, but right now, just pay attention to you know, a lot of the injuries going on. There's still a lot of people who really don't know who may play or not just yet. I like I said, I like my Buffalo Bill, Carlos Williams.
Right.
Like I said, I think he's one of my, you know, he's definitely very high on my list. Vince McCoy's, like I said, not playing. He's one, you know, that I would definitely consider.
I wouldn't throw one in. I think Charles Clay is a sleeper.
Yeah, Charles Clay is definitely a sleeper tight end as well. This week. You know, yeah. If you own and also too, I did scoop up Clay in a few leagues as well. Because again, you got Gronk, you got Delanie Walker; those guys on bye weeks. Right. Clay's a great pickup. You know, he had a great game last week. You know, I'm looking at Taylor. You know, who and also since my guy. Watkins is not playing. Sammy's not playing. Then Clay's going to definitely get a lot of touch. So, yeah, definitely. He's definitely one that I would definitely consider starting this week as well.
All right. All right, Vince, we definitely appreciate it, man. Yes, that definitely concludes the odds and alls of fantasy football.
Absolutely.
Go ahead, man. I know you're representing the Bears. I know you're excited.
Yes. I'm ready.
We'll see you next time. Next
all right, week. Guys, go Bills.
Make sure you check out his article, week 4, fantasy week 4, alls and alls on the 3pointconversion.com website. And we'll be back in a second. All right, so we are back at 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge. And we all know what time it is. It's time for that infamous segment. Yes, sir, stop it. All right, so Glass, you're up. What you have for us this week, man?
Okay, you know what? We had so many stopping moments at the beginning with the quick hit. It was hard to even find some, but I'm gonna have to go ahead with the let me get the name right. It's popping up right now. The sorority sisters. I can't get the sorority name, but they was at Arizona State University. They went to a Diamondbacks game, and they doggone every one of them during the whole game took a selfie. The whole game. What? The name of the sorority is Alpha Chi Omega. They had Arizona State University. They went to a Diamondbacks professional baseball game. And the whole time, I mean, constantly, they were sitting there, not even paying attention to the game. They taking selfies.
What?
So, yeah, they get a stop it moment from me.
For real, man.
Yeah.
Wow. So during the whole game.
The whole game. If you Google sorority sisters at a Diamondbacks game, they got a video. And the announcers was going off on them. Like, not wishing bad on them. But you know how people was getting hit in the face with the baseball? They looking at their phone? Yeah, somebody need to shoot a line drive out that way.
Wow. Yeah, for real. See, man, that's why, like I said, nothing against – I don't have anything against women that don't know sport. I don't have anything against men that don't like sports. If you don't like sports, fine, but don't come to the game then.
Right.
You're coming because you spoil it for everybody. You do when you're doing stuff like – that would annoy the mess out of me. I probably would have got so mad and grabbed the camera and threw it onto the field. You know, like, don't – come on, man.
Somebody who really want to watch the game could use them seats. I think there was about 30 of them. Like, for real?
Yeah, so, like, that's why I say that's – I don't know. But, okay. So, my stopping moment is – so, anybody remember a person named Steve Bartman?
Oh, come on, man. Really?
Okay. I don't like to even bring up his name because the playoffs are starting. But how about there is a campaign? So they're doing a fundraising drive for Steve Bartman to attend the Cubs' first playoff game since, I think, 2000 and – was it 10, 8, 10? What? It's their first playoff game this season, this year. They're going to they're trying to get him. So they've raised over, I think it was, they're trying to raise $5,000. They raised $2,500 so far. Even though Steve Bartman said no thanks, but you're really trying to bring this guy. It's so many levels on this actual topic of stop it. First of all, the fact that you're trying to raise money for something dumb like this. But then if you're a Cubs fan, why are you bringing this idiot to the game? Hey, man, I'm superstitious, but not like you step on a brother's, you know, step on a crack, you break your mother's back. I ain't, whatever. Walk on the ladder. Nah. But I am superstitious as far as, especially with the Bears. And if I drank some orange juice and we won or ate some tortilla chips, I'll make sure I do that every game so we can win. But you gonna bring this guy in who kept us out of the World Series? Man.
Sorry, Glass. Wait a minute. I'm going to tell you to stop it. Stop it, man. You can't blame everything on Bartman, man. Man,
don't bring the joke into the game, dog.
The dude did something that everybody would do in their position. It just was at the wrong place at the wrong time.
Because I don't want to see that dumb look on his face.
The Cubs could have won.
Good Lord. But you know what?
I mean, won that game, man. There's still enough time on the clock.
But hold on. But you know what though? Honestly though, I'll say this. I didn't know that I watched his documentary. And I didn't know that he didn't realize because when he made the dumb play, you know, he was to the radio, didn't nobody know who it was at first. And then when they put him on blast, he didn't know that at first that everybody was targeting him. He didn't know. Until on TV and radio, next thing you know, that's when the security guard came
and got him. Yeah,
and that's when he knew. And it's an interesting story. You should Google it. It's very interesting. Yeah. But yeah, bro, don't bring that joke in there. You know what I'm saying?
They bring him up in there. They can't bring him up in there. The fans not gonna let him. There ain't enough bulletproof vests out here in the world, man. Ain't enough Kevlar.
Right.
Yeah, don't bring that man up in there. Just show him on a jumbotron somewhere at some bar and leave it at that. Don't bring him in the park, man.
right. So let me ask you, man.
Yeah.
With this college football Saturday, some big games going on in college football.
Yes, sir.
But before we even get to the games, I want to ask you about the Big Ten. We all know SEC is supposedly the best conference in college.
Supposedly,
it's starting to slip.
What?
Name one quarterback in the SEC that's good.
Just because you don't have a quarterback don't mean.
No. Answer go ahead. What day? One quarterback in
SEC. Has there ever been a quarterback in SEC with their weight and salt?
No, it's been some nice quarterbacks in the SEC.
Name one.
Dak.
Who?
What's his name? Dak Prescott. I liked him last year.
No. Dak Prescott, I'm going to put it out. It sounds like I'm throwing shade. Dak Prescott is like the Tim Tebow, the black Tim Tebow.
But he was decent, though. I mean, he was – and I'm not saying your quarterback has to throw for 300 yards a game. I'm not saying that. But somebody we can say, oh, man, I got to watch this quarterback. He nice. Dak was it last year.
Okay.
That was it. The year before last, maybe you had Murray, you know. You still had the Alabama quarterback. I can't think of his name. But you had him. You had the one who won championships. Mm-hmm. So you had quarterbacks. Back then,
but did you have quarterback? Okay, I can't remember the Alabama quarterback that you're talking about. I can't remember his name offhand. Yes, you had. He won championships, but they didn't win championships off his arm. He was doggone the ultimate game manager, to me.
He was a winner.
McElroy, something like that.
No, it's not McElroy. I can't think of it. But yeah, you close to it, but I can't think of his name. Mm-hmm. But yeah. You can't tell me that he was a quarterback like that. Remember that game when they played LSU? Was it? It's 2015 now, so it had to be what, 2011? Mm-hmm. And the game where LSU ended up winning, it was a slow game, like running defense, like it usually is. But he kind of stepped up from that, and then after that, they won the title. Then the next year, he was just that quarterback.
I'll look it up.
It's right at the tip of my tongue. But anyway, I liked him, you know. Okay. But right now, there's no quarterbacks in the SEC. But the reason why I bring this up is right now, I think the Big Ten, not the best conference. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying right now, the way the Big Ten is playing, the Big Ten is stepping up. And you answer me this, Glass. Do you think Big Ten right now is creeping up to where now this is about to be a conference, or if it isn't already, to be reckoned with?
I have to agree with you. It's a conference that's under the radar. The two prominent teams, Ohio State and Michigan State. But let's not knock Michigan. They 3-1. Northwestern undefeated. Iowa undefeated. Indiana's undefeated. They don't have any conference play right now, but they're undefeated. Yeah, I don't remember the last time we could say there was more than three teams that were undefeated in the Big Ten. So I agree with you. Slowly but surely, they moving up. Let's not forget Penn State. After that scandal, Sandusky scandal, they've been moving up. So I totally agree with you. The Big Ten is, you know, up and coming. You know, I understand everybody, the SEC, Pac-12, all them teams out there, they're doing a great job. But don't throw any – just don't forget about the Big Ten.
And see, the Big Ten, they have – the top two ranked teams in the country right now.
Right.
You know, when is the last time we could when is the last time, I think besides last year, that we could say that they had two top 10 teams, teams in the top 10.
Exactly.
You know, so.
And let's not forget about Wisconsin. I almost forgot about Wisconsin.
Yeah, Northwestern, Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. Like I said, so right now at the AP, in the AP polls right now, you have Ohio State, Michigan State, they're 1-2, right? Mm-hmm. Then Northwestern is 16, Wisconsin is 19, Michigan is 22. Like, come on, man. When is the last time we could say that?
Right.
And you got to remember, Michigan is playing well now. They're playing very well. And Yeah, I know they lost to Utah earlier, but they're playing well right now. And these are still not Harbaugh's boys.
Exactly. I was just about to mention that. You're right. Go ahead.
So we won't see a real Michigan team until maybe next year or the year after, because that'll be their sophomore year. But I'm telling you, Ohio State, Michigan State, and Michigan, those teams right there are going to be powerhouses in college football, I think.
Right. Speaking of Alabama, and I hate Alabama, just to let y'all know.
Me too.
They're not even the top 25.
Yes, they are.
Oh, yes, they are. I'm sorry. Where they at, number?
Look, you're because you already know if Alabama was 0-3 right now, they'd be 25.
They're 13, right?
Yeah, they'll be 25. Okay. You know they'll be 25. So, but this is my thing.
Mm-hmm.
With that Alabama, since you brought them up, the Alabama-Georgia game, that game, that's a big game, but it's a real big game this year because it means a lot to both teams. Mm-hmm. But still, I think that this game is not as big as it was when you had – the Alabama of old playing against like a Murray type team when Murray was the quarterback for Georgia.
Right. Right. So, oh, and sorry to interrupt you, but to answer your question, I did a quick check on the Alabama quarterback. Last year was Blake Sims, and the year before that was AJ McCarron.
McCarron's. I couldn't think. I knew it was something. I couldn't think of McCarron's. I don't know why I keep forgetting AJ's name. He was one of my favorite quarterbacks in college. Even though I hated Alabama, he was a favorite quarterback of mine. But, yeah, so the Alabama-Georgia game played today in Athens at 3:30. Tell me who's going to win and why?
Between the Alabama-Georgia game, correct?
Right.
Georgia going to win hands down. And I'm this is not a biased opinion, just like I said. I know I say I hate the Alabama Crimson Tide, but it is what it is. But Georgia has a more complete team than Alabama. Alabama, to me, is overrated. They rank 13. I think they're going to drop after this game. The running back, Chubbs, he's going to wreck shop with that team. I heard what you said. You like the running back for Alabama. I mean, I ain't going to throw no shade on them, but Chubbs is in the running for the Heisman Trophy. And right now, I can't see the Alabama. And that's another thing about Alabama. Alabama don't have that defense like they used to have.
Well,
Alabama don't have that offensive line like they used to have.
Well, that defensive line is beasting, though. They probably – they're in the top five right now, not the best defensive line in college. They have a great defensive line. That's going to be the key because with Chubbs running the ball, they're going to have to run outside, you know, off tackle or outside, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Sweeps, because that D-line, that's their strength. Now, I'll say this with the Alabama defense, the DBs, I think, is where you can hurt them. And I don't say throw the ball. Georgia should just concentrate on throwing it all day because you don't want to do that. And even though I like Grayson,
okay. I do,
and Grayson Lambert, the quarterback for Georgia, want to look at the quarterback matchup. You got Coker for Alabama, and you got Lambert for Georgia. Coker is 68 for 123. I think he has four or five interceptions. I'm sorry. Lambert has 7 TDs, no interceptions, and he's 52 for 68. Now, true enough, he was 90, I think it was 93 or 96% against South Carolina, but their defense is water. so, that, you know, take that with a grain of salt. But still, he can throw the ball. And with that suspect secondary for Alabama, I think they have somewhere to go. Now, I'm not, like I said, I don't say throw it every, you should throw it, what, 60%? No. But you will have some chances to beat him, especially with Malcolm Mitchell.
Okay.
Receiver.
I totally – you know what? I agree with you. I still think Chubb's going to run the ball. But like you said, I think, if I am mistaken, Alabama's rushing defense is fourth in the country.
Right.
But Georgia defense, they not you know, punks. They top in the passing defense and rushing defense. I think that's going to come to play – against that Alabama offense, you know. So I'm still going to pick the Georgia Bulldogs over the Crimson Tide. Where's the game at?
It's in Athens.
That's going to be a factor too.
But then let's look at this though. With Henry has to get off. He has to have a dominant game for Alabama to win. Because you can't depend on Coker. But not another factor I put in this though. Alabama was the underdogs.
Right.
When is the last time? I think it was 27 games, probably more than that. Mm-hmm. Don't quote me, you all. But for a Nick Saban team to be an underdog, and now I guarantee you Alabama's coming to play. I think Georgia was mad at the fact that they had Alabama as an underdog because you know Nick Saban don't like that. You know how Nick Saban is.
Right.
So, honestly, I want Georgia to win, but I had Alabama winning.
What?
I just think Alabama, two reasons. Maybe we shouldn't say this because we're supposed to be in, you know, we're talking to sports, but oh well, this is a fan show.
We're fans. I'm about to say we're fans, bro.
Somehow they're going to cheat and they want Alabama to be in there. You know how it is. So let's look for that.
Wow.
But also, again, Nick's going to have that team ready. You know, he's going to have that team ready to play. And it's, thing is, it's wet. It's raining out here. I just have Alabama some way, somehow. And funny thing is, if Alabama wins, it's going to – like I said, that loss didn't do anything to Alabama when they lost to Ole Miss.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was early in the season.
Right.
And they're moving up.
Right.
So,
if you're going to lose in college football, you got to lose early.
Right.
Exactly. I totally agree. Yeah.
So, the next game – the Notre Dame Clemson game in Death Valley. Who do you have there? That's a big game too. That's a real big game.
If can't remember his name right now. If the official starting quarterback for Notre Dame, Zaire, was that his name?
Zaire was playing.
If he was playing, I might give Notre Dame some credit, but and not putting shade on the backup quarterback. But
I like Kaiser.
I like Clemson.
I like Kaiser because
Kaiser's
nice too. I mean, he's not as he's not as dynamic as Zaire, but he's nice. He's came in well. I think he has 599 yards in this short time playing, but. But then Clemson, like you said, Deshaun Watson, that quarterback, is a beast too.
Yeah.
But the thing about this game, it's not even with X's and O's because Notre Dame is talented. We all know that. And that's a talented team, man. I mean, that's a scary team right now, the way they're playing. And they're better than that team that went to the championship and got embarrassed by Alabama. But – if you look at Clemson's history, their coach, is it Dabo Sweeney, whatever his name is, Sweeney, he can't win the big game. Think about 2 years ago. You were more talented than that Florida State team with Jameis Winston that came into Death Valley. More talented. And you got blown out on a Saturday night? This is an 8 o'clock game too.
Right, right.
So, like I said, to me, it's not about X's and O's. It's not about on the field. It's about coaching. I don't think he's ready. Mm-hmm. I don't think he can win a big game. What big game has Clemson won under Sweeney?
None. And the bad thing about it, Sweeney is a good coach. I will not say he's a great coach just for the simple fact of what you just mentioned. He'll have the team in the game. It's like sometimes after halftime, he don't motivate the team, don't adjust to what's on the field, and that's where he loses the game. So there's many high profile games Clemson should have won, but didn't because he didn't prep the team right. That's just me.
Right. So that's why I say I have Notre Dame. And like I said, Notre Dame is talented. That he's talented. That I mean, they're talented. There's nothing else to say about their team, man. That those wide receivers, the way they play, they're physical, and I think they're gonna go in Death Valley and beat Clemson, man. That's what I got.
All I gotta say, Mr. Controversy, make sure you're on Twitter, because when these games finish and I'm winning both my Georgia pick and my Clemson pick come to fruition, I'm gonna put you on blast on Twitter, bro.
Do it. But look, I want Georgia to win. I just think Alabama's gonna win, man.
Okay. Okay.
And you said you have Clemson, right? I think Notre Dame's gonna win. Clemson never wins that big game.
Clock right twice. Broken clock is right twice in a day. Just put it like that. Is it gonna be a time where it's
gonna have a broken clock, man? Because
hey, before we move on, I had to put this out there. I have to put this out there. Leonard Fournette doing the thing out there at LSU.
Yeah,
ESPN's Jamel Hill put it out there that she thinks Fournette should sit out next season. Just make sure he's healthy for the NFL draft. Okay. Number one, I can't see Fournette doing that. He loves LSU from Louisiana, and he's all for the team. But let's put it out there. I think it's crazy. I don't think anybody should sit out. But I believe that the three-year wait from your high school graduation, that's bogus to me. If anything, bring it down one more year, sophomore year, instead of junior year. What you think?
Well, if they qualify, they can get in after sophomore year. But, man, history has proven some running backs are not ready or some players are not ready after that. Look, okay.
I said sophomore year. I see some people saying like straight out of high school. Right. That's crazy.
Right, because I think what's the word I'm looking for? But you can try to get in after your sophomore year. But you're right. I maybe sophomore year. But I'm just saying, it's a few players that I believe in my lifetime that could have went after straight the sophomore year.
Right.
Herschel Walker could have went after his freshman year. Bo Jackson.
Yep.
Believe it or not, I think Maurice Claret.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree.
And if he wouldn't have got hurt, Marcus Dupree.
Yeah.
Played for Oklahoma.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
I believe those players, running backs.
Running back. Oh, I believe.
I think Adrian Peterson could have came out of high school and went to the NFL. So,
you know what? I understand the health issue with the players coming out of high school. That's the reason. We're dealing with concussions right now with NFL players.
Mm-hmm.
High school players ain't ready for that. No. For that car crash that they're going to get every game that they play. But to me, 3 years, junior year or 3 years after graduation from high school, that's bogus, man. And I believe they put it up so high because they know if they brought it down freshman year, sophomore year, whatever, they'll be like the college basketball. You're going to have any players playing
right
in the game. But as everybody say, if you are number one, college needs to stop saying that we give them free education. Yeah, you giving them $100,000 free education, but you gaining millions every Saturday.
Forget that, because if they get hurt, they can take the scholarship back.
Exactly. So don't bring up that BS no more. You know what I'm saying? But I do understand with the health issues, because everybody ain't ready. It's only a handful of players ready to go into the NFL, but find another way to do so.
That's right. No, I'm with you. I definitely agree 100%. Yeah, I understand what Jamel is saying, but she bugging. I won't even say she's bugging. I won't even say
right.
that.
Right.
I wouldn't. She shouldn't say that. Mm-hmm. I feel her.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's Todd Gurley.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know,
but.
Good example.
No. Shoot.
Sam Bradford, AP, Adrian Peterson, he broke his collarbone.
Right. And look what he did, though. He came back in and
He a freak. He's an alien.
Yeah.
Can't even put him in. Can't even put him in that conversation, man.
Right. He's an alien. Speaking of NFL, we have four games, man, that we want to get into, ladies and gentlemen. We want to talk about these games, and we want to analyze these games. So the first game, which, like Mr. Vincent, Fantasy Guru, told us, the 9:30 a.m., make sure you Eastern time, make sure you get your stuff right. But the New York Jets plays Miami Dolphins. What's your take on this, Glass?
Okay. Before the season even started, I gave high praises to the Miami Dolphins. That came back to put pie in my face. They playing like ish. They're not playing as a team. Joe Philbin's is in the hot seat. I don't think he has control of the team. I don't think he had control of the team when they had the bullying situation. He is a coordinator. He is not a head coach. That being said, I like what the Jets are doing. I know they lost. I think they lost last week to Buffalo, if I'm mistaken. I can't remember offhand.
Right.
I like what Bowles is doing out there. Get that defense prepped because he was defensive coordinator. He got the offense running real good with Ryan Fitzpatrick. Our used to be great wide receiver, Brandon Marshall. Eric Dick, I think he's still hurt, but they got everything going. Chris Ivey doing what he's doing. That being said, it's easy. I know it's going to be an early morning game. I know they got a little jet lag, but I'm going with the Jets over the Dolphins.
This was a tough one for me because I think with Miami, you look at the game Baltimore played, even though they started off horrible, but the way they played, like a desperate team. And I think Miami right now, with Buffalo playing the way they're playing, New England, of course, and then the Jets could be 3-1. If they lose this game, it's a wrap. So I think they'll have a sense of urgency. But Lamar Miller, man, where is he? And then check out this article. Go to the 3pointconversion.com website. Shout out to Todd Vandenberg. He wrote this excellent article on why it's too late to fire Joe Philbin.
Okay.
Excellent. And it's true, because he should have been fired a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what's going on in that coaching staff and the meetings. Like, what are they seeing? Like I said, I've been saying, to me, I don't think that roster is talented. I like Jarvis Landry, but he's what I call your wild card receiver, your gimmick receiver. And when I mean gimmick, not to discount him, I'm just saying he's that you can put him anywhere, you could run the bubble screens, but he's not your typical number one wide receiver.
Mm-hmm.
So they're lacking depth at the wide receiver spot. I like this kid Matthews. I like him. He's looking nice, but they're not good. And like I said, Lamar Miller is just not playing up to par. And what's going on with Sue?
Man, forget Sue. What's going on with Cameron Lake? What's going on with that defense? Did they even have a sack?
See, that's what I'm saying. And we all know Cameron Wake used to be that dude
used to be that dude.
Yeah. And you think teaming him up with Sue?
Right.
So it's kind of hard. I picked the Jets, I picked the Jets.
Okay.
Mainly just because of that defense. That's the only reason why I'm picking the Jets, because of that defense. If Chris Ivory comes back and play, he can be a difference maker. But, hey, sometimes when you go out of the country, that right. might get that morale back in the locker room for the Miami Dolphins. So. But I'm gonna pick up.
I'm not putting my faith up in the Miami Dolphins. I don't care if it's outside the country. It's a divisional game, so it's a important game to both teams. But yeah, I'm going with the Jets. And I did a little research. One sack. That's all they have. The whole team. One sack, and that was by Jordan Phillips.
Yeah, that sucks. Yeah. Okay. All right. So our second game, the St. Louis Rams. I was about to say St. Louis Cardinals. I remember that when they were the St. Louis Cardinals. St. Louis Rams traveled to Arizona to play the Arizona Cardinals.
It's going to be a hell of a game, bro. Yes, this is going to be a nice little NFC West battle. I've always said I liked the St. Louis Rams. Jeff Fisher, great coach. He going to have that team motivated. But let's not forget Bruce Arians, who should have been a Chicago Bears coach. I'm just going to put it out there. He got that team blowing on all cylinders. Just like I said before, they got the whole team is playing up to par.
Mm-hmm.
Special teams, defense, offense, that secondary, the Honey Badger, Peterson, they jamming. So nothing against Nick Foles. He better not pass it too far down deep on them. They got to go with the run game. I like the run game of St. Louis. It's going to be a close game. I think it's going to be by a touchdown or by a field goal, but I'm going to go with the home team, the Arizona Cardinals, to win this game.
All right, I have the St. Louis Rams winning this game. Yeah, I think this is the first real matchup that Arizona will play. Mm-hmm. It has played in the first 4 weeks. You know, they've all played except for who did they play last week?
Except for the Cardinals.
Sorry, week before last. Except for the 49ers.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only team that has won a game. The rest of the team. So combined, they are 1-9. A combined 1-9. The teams they played are 1-8. I'm sorry, 1-8. So that's why I have the Rams, because they haven't been tested. Not saying that Arizona will step up, but this is Carson's real test and that offensive line real test to see what they're going to do against a D-line that's just remarkable.
Totally agree.
Man, that guy Aaron Donaldson is a beast. That dude cannot be blocked. I mean, you know who he reminds me of? And I know a lot of people don't like this guy outside of the lines. Might not have liked him in between the lines. It was Warren Sapp. He's that Warren Sapp type that can disrupt, you know, that D-tackle that can get you. I think he had 12 sacks last year, 10 to 12 sacks last year. So he can get you 12 to 14 sacks, a D-tackle, but still clog up that middle and disrupt the backfield and get tackled. So with that defensive line and the fact that Nick Foles can make throws when he needs to.
Okay.
I like that. So I'm picking the Rams.
Okay.
And special teams. I'm picking the Rams. I'm going Rams.
You know, like I said, it's a hard game for me to pick because, I do like the Rams. And just like you said, that defensive line is full of number one picks. That's one thing I like about St. Louis Rams. They're almost doing the Green Bay they almost are the Green Bay prototype, working within the system, you bringing up your own players. So, yeah. It's going to be, like I said, it's going to be a great game. I will be watching it, but, yeah, I'm picking the Cardinals, bro.
Okay, so this game, I might get a stopper from this game, but we're talking New York Giants or the Buffalo Bills. And the only reason why I picked this game is just because you got to think about it. Giants just won, so they're on the high. Giants, from top to bottom, they're not a bad team.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they should have won game one against Dallas Cowboys.
They should have won the first two games. They should be 3-0.
They should be exactly. It should be 3-0. So they're not a bad team.
Right.
So with that win, is this going to give them confidence against Buffalo? We all know about Buffalo.
Mm-hmm. So
what say you, Glass?
I'm going to go ahead and pick the Buffalo Bills. They're going to win the Battle of New York for the simple fact, just like you stated. They should have been 3-0, but mental lapses from both the head coach and the quarterback, that's not going to happen with Rex Ryan and Tyrod Taylor.
Right.
I put the Bills' defense over New York's defense and New York's offense. I just think they're more settled in for the long run for the season. Giants, they still trying to get themselves together. Like I said, they have mental brain farts and it messed them up the first two games. I'm definitely going to pick the Buffalo Bills over the New York Giants. Where's the game playing at?
It's in Buffalo.
There you go. That's another factor. So yeah. The Bills would be 3-1, while the right. Giants would be 1-3.
I got Buffalo. I think Buffalo right now, they might have the – I think they might have the best defense in the NFL right now, the way they're playing. I think so. They might not be as talented from front to back like Seattle. Mm-hmm. But as of right now, even though New England put that almost 40 burger on them, but yeah. I have Buffalo. I mean, they're just great defensively, you know. And like Vince said, I think Carlos Williams is going to be a handful against the Giants running that ball. When I think about it, also, Giants haven't played against – they hadn't played against a team that can run the ball. And I think Buffalo will run the ball. I think Rex liked this because he has a big back that's going to bruise and run the ball. They couldn't run the ball before because LeSean, he still wasn't 100%. And we give kudos to LeSean because LeSean's been playing hurt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can tell because those are not his numbers, but he's not himself. But I like that Carlos Williams kid. I like him. But also – as you mentioned earlier, Tyrod Taylor, man, that dude is poised. We don't give him enough credit. He's poised.
Right.
And, I expect a tip pass from Eli is going to go for a touchdown. You know how it is.
Right.
Mess up. And, man, when is that number 15 kid going to get dropped? This dude he's dropped like – the first game, he dropped 4 passes. The second game, he dropped 3. Like, come on, bro.
Hey, man. They're known for that. Just like the running back they used to have. I can't remember his name. He used to drop passes. And they gave him chances. It didn't work out. So he's going to get a couple more chances.
Right. So I have Buffalo. And then the last game, which I think is more interesting than what it looks on paper, is the Kansas City Chiefs versus the Cincinnati Bengals.
Dude, I'm not an Andy Dalton fan. Andy Dalton has superb regular season. I question his postseason. With that being said, he got a lot of weapons. He got a stout defense. On the other hand, Kansas City Chiefs, they could be up and coming. And I'm just going to put it out there, y'all. I don't know how y'all feel about it. Let us know. I'm not sold on Alex Smith. I've stated time and time again, this man cannot throw past 30 yards. I know he got Jeremy Maclin on the team. That don't mean nothing. The wide receiver, he's doing his job. Alex Smith can't get the ball out there. I know I used to get banged on about calling Alex Smith a game manager. What else is he? I wonder if somebody explained to me what else is he if he's not a game manager. He's a game manager, and the team around him got to work their butt off. It is what it is. But with that being said, Cincinnati – all around is a better team than Kansas City Chiefs. I'm going to pick the Cincinnati Bengals over the Kansas City Chiefs. Kansas City going to bring that defense. They got a top five defense. But Alex Smith, in order for you to win the game, you got to put points on the board. Alex Smith not doing that.
True. I'm mad at myself because on the 3pointconversion.com website, I didn't pick Kansas City. I went with Cincinnati. And I felt – I'm not giving myself an excuse, but I'm mad at myself because I was rushed. I didn't have
– What?
No, for real. I didn't take time, for real. Because this game right here, when I look at it now, easy. Well, not easy, but I'm going with Kansas City. I think Kansas City could beat Cincinnati. I'm going to go with Cincinnati just because I picked them. But, man, honestly, I want to pick Kansas City. Just because I think Kansas City finally got their groove, and I think they've done the unthinkable. Alex Smith threw a touchdown to a wide receiver.
When was that?
Monday night.
So okay. That
might get him off the snide, you know. But Kansas City looked bad because it's hard to play against that. You're going against Aaron Rodgers and Green Bay at Lambeau Field, so you're not going to fare well. But against a Cincinnati Bengals team, even though you're on the road in Cincinnati, I don't think Cincinnati has like a great home crowd advantage. You know, I don't look at that stadium like that. But I think Alex Smith is going to play like he usually plays. Won't turn the ball over. If Jamal Charles can have a great game and if wide receivers get involved, and of course, that defensive line, you know, those beasts up front with Ali and Houston, if they create havoc, Kansas City has a great chance of beating the Cincinnati Bengals. So I definitely have Cincinnati Bengals, man, winning that game. We'll see. Also,